The crib notes. Hello, everybody. Welcome to Wisdom Wednesday today, Teresa.
Hello, everybody.
Thanks for being here with me today. I was trying to figure out what topic to talk about today, and I decided that there's always so many topics, right? It's crazy. But one of the things that sinks people on a regular basis is the habits they've formed over their lifetime and trying to change them because it perhaps is not serving them well at this point. So we all have them. We all have habits. It could be as simple as, right, when we're stressed, we bite our nails. What do you do when you're stressed?
I cook, which means I eat.
Okay.
So, and even though it's more about the cooking and stuff like that, but I will like force feed the people around me. My family calls it my love language, but when I'm really stressed out, I either force feed or I just get angry. But that's why I channel into like cooking or something. Let me love on people. Instead, I'm like force feeding them large meals. And my husband is, blaming me for his heartburn. I don't know.
No, it's true. And I'm trying to think, when I'm stressed, I also eat, which is not the best thing in the world to do. Sometimes I just sort of hunker down and don't talk to anybody. Right.
So I'll disconnect from the world, like completely shut down and disconnect. I do that too. I used to smoke, but I quit smoking like 15
years. Me too.
So that was one of the best things I did, but I would like chain smoke, I mean, we all have those bad habits that we fall into.
And it could be addicted to social media. It could be TV watching. And here's the bottom line. I say habit, it doesn't necessarily have to be a bad habit, but it could be a habit that is not serving your goals in your life right now. Right?
Yeah. And I know you have a book you want to talk about, but it reminds me of a book that I read. I think it's called Soft Addictions or something like that. I read it years ago, but it was talking about those little things that aren't bad, but when done in excess, they're an addiction, like being on social media for hours and hours and hours rather than working on the new business proposal that you have, or those kind of things. Like, we all have those little soft addictions. They're not bad things, but when they derail us from our goals, they're not serving us.
Exactly. And I've been doing the Crib Notes version of The Power of Habit by Charles Duhigg, I think his name is. And it's something you almost, he gives you the science behind habits. So it's a little painful to get through, right? Because the minute you go sciencey on me, I'm like, oh, wait, I don't get it. Like, I need to go back and listen to it again and then turn it into my version. So the way I understand it is what everyone may know, right? There's a trigger. What is something that's triggering you? Then there's a behavior that you do. And then there's a reward at the end. You have to understand the trigger and the reward really well before you can start changing it. And the reward to me is the most baffling because you can't always figure out what is the reward of doing that bad habit that's keeping you from your goals. There's got to be a reward. And what he outlines so nicely in this book is that it's not as obvious as you think it may be. And he used nail biting as, right? When they ask nail biters to really get to their trigger, their cue, it's called, why they start nail biting, they'll say, like, I'm bored, I'm stressed, right? That's easy. Okay, that's an easy thing. Like, I eat when I'm bored and I'm stressed.
Right.
But what's the reward? If we go back to nail biting for a moment, and it was fascinating when people actually started figuring out what the reward was. The reward is a reduction in their stress, but why? Why is it nail biting or cuticle biting? How is it changing your stress level? And what they found out is the split second pain you might feel at some point when you're like, it overrides the emotional pain of loneliness or anxiety. So that physical pain overrode the emotional pain. which was scary to me, because this is why a lot of young people cut themselves, right? Emotionally.
Yeah.
That's how I equated it. And I was like, oh, like, I don't want to go there. But if I look at some of my bad habits, I go, okay, what is my reward? It's something I have to figure out, because when I find out the trigger, okay, I recognize I'm bored right now. Normally what I would do is eat. Mm-hmm. What is that eating doing? What is the actual reward of the eating, right? And to get to that reward without the eating is the key.
Right.
Right. So if I'm trying to do a work presentation and I keep, I'm anxious because I can't focus and I don't want to get through it. Or some people might be putting together proposals or having to concentrate for 2 hours, which is really hard to do in this day and age.
Mm-hmm.
You then revert to some bad habit to avoid. But there is some kind of reward from whatever you're choosing. And mm-hmm. to try to figure out what that is so hard sometimes.
Well, and it's interesting too, that makes perfect sense to me, but I'm thinking about like, what's the reward of like being stuck in social media for hours? And it's an escape. It's that numbness to where we don't have to face our insecurities of doing that business proposal, that insecurities of charging our worth, the insecurities of should I, you know, like all of those things. So we're avoiding, we're becoming numb to that. And the reward is we have that escape and that numbness, and we're not feeling those emotions. But we also don't feel those emotions once we get done with the proposal.
Exactly, right? So you feel the trigger. I'm trying to avoid it. I'm going to avoid it because the reward is, and like you said, I kind of can go brain dead and not worry about it and not get anxious about sending a proposal that's higher in price than I think the client's going to want and all that anxiety that's coming up. Right. So you go into an avoidance habit of some kind.
Yep.
But what you just said is the reward is I don't have to think about it anymore. I'm going into brain numb. The same reward would happen if you actually did it.
Yeah.
And got it out the door. Right. Yeah. But it's something that, you know, what's interesting about this book is he said it's not about willpower at all. Like willpower doesn't really exist. It's about recognizing the cue or the trigger, figuring out what the reward of that middle part, the habit is giving, and then trying to find another way to get to that reward in a healthier way.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's just a whole, you know, and listen, this is a live where I'm not necessarily giving like, you know, do this, do that, and do that, like these three tips. This is more of a conversation of bringing awareness to, because this is what I'm going through right now in my personal life. Well, I shouldn't say my personal life, my life in its entirety. There are certain things that I want to create more space and time in my life for other things. And why am I not doing that? I'm distracting myself with other things. And what is the reward of that? And trying to figure it out. So breaking bad habits is about recognition. Acknowledgement, taking
awareness.
Yeah. One of the things that he has people do is a simple, get an index card. And every time there's a, let's say you are still a smoker, or let's say you go numb out at the TV when you're stressed. Every time you feel the trigger, just take the index card and put a check mark. You don't have to write a whole, it's not a diary. You don't have to put anything, but put a check mark. I've recognized the fact that I am resorting to this habit that isn't serving me. Like if you just start with that, the recognition of the trigger, it's going to be very helpful.
Mm-hmm.
Then figuring out what is the habit you're doing, and then really digging into, okay, now I watch TV for 2 hours and numbed my brain, or I smoked or whatever it is. What is the reward of that? And what they find a lot with smokers is the reward is that they're actually just stepping away.
Yep. That was my reward, was stepping away and taking slower breaths, you know, like slowing down, even though they weren't healthy breaths, they were full of toxins, but taking slower breaths and stepping out of a situation, that was the reward. And even though it's been 15 years, I still get cravings for cigarettes. It's crazy.
Me too. Once a smoker, always a smoker, but we just don't. We don't act on the trigger anymore for the unhealthy, right?
Right.
So and the other reward of something like smoking for me was always that social aspect.
Yes.
And the smokers always stand outside and chat. So, okay. So my replacement when I quit smoking again, which has been a while now, was to make sure I connect with somebody and then make sure I'm breathing.
Yeah.
And stepping away. So that three, that combination, stepping away, breathing, and calling somebody could get me that same feeling once I broke the physical addiction. Mm-hmm. The emotional habit is what you then have to break.
Yes.
Right.
And that was the hardest part to break. I will admit, for me, that was the hardest part to break when it came to the smoking. And even like the overcooking that I do, you know, like it's just my husband and my son and I, but my son's about to move out and I cook way more than is necessary. And we're throwing away food all the time. Like then I'm creating more work for myself. So, you know, there's, even though it doesn't look like a bad thing, cooking and eating, it's, you've got to figure out another way to channel that.
Well, yeah, because the bottom line is it's individual. If it's not serving your goals,
yeah.
If it's distracting you from possibly doing one more thing with your business because you're just avoiding it, which is going to make it that much harder to achieve your goals, yeah. Right? So breaking a bad habit with your business is the same thing. Do you tend to go down this numb social media rabbit hole in order to avoid doing a proposal or actually reaching out and talking to a potential client or following up on something that makes you nervous? So recognizing, put a check mark on a card every time you recognize that I'm going into this avoidance, bad behavior or bad habit.
I love that check mark idea.
Yeah, because that I think that's the first step, is that awareness. And then figuring out, okay, I went down the social media rabbit hole. What did that actually do for me? What was my reward of doing that? And if your reward can be duplicated by doing something else that's healthier and more focused on your goals, that's what you're trying to choose. You're trying to replace the habit. You're not necessarily just trying to go cold turkey. Does that make sense?
It makes perfect sense, because I know what I like when I'm in my coaching business, I would have to let, you know, remind people willpower is just a bunk. I hate willpower because it makes you feel weak and ineffective and all these other things. Like it just really messes with your brain. But yeah. I'm like, the change has got to feel better than staying stuck. The change has to have more of a reward or equal reward than staying stuck. So it makes perfect sense with that, you know, to me.
Yeah.
Because you've got to start feeling good. If the change is painful, if breaking that habit is painful and we don't give ourselves a reward, it's just punishment.
Right. And you'll slip back. You'll just slip back to old habits.
I mean, really quickly, you'll slip right back in.
Yeah. For me, I definitely think that biggest thing was the acknowledgement in the beginning. Oh, the trigger. It's here. Recognizing it, taking a moment, putting a check mark down, going, okay, I recognize this is normally when I would go to the refrigerator. This is normally when I would go numb out on social media or TV, or this is normally when I would, you know, pour myself a glass of wine, let's say. Instead, yeah. It's like, okay, here it is. Here's the trigger. What was the reward when I used to go down the social media rabbit hole? The reward was that I got a break from my stress. So instead, maybe I should take a walk around the block.
Yeah.
To get a break from my stress and then come back and then put on a timer for 20 minutes and just focus on, you know, focusing for 20 minutes and seeing how much you can get done.
Yes. Yes.
Right.
Yeah. And I want to toss one thing too I learned on this. That's the Pomodoro technique. And I'm listening to this book by Carrie Richardson right now. And she talks about how she made a promise to herself when she set the timer. If she really did not want to do what she was supposed to do, she could do nothing. Nothing for 20 minutes. So if she did not, if she really was going to procrastinate doing whatever the task was, that was, she gave herself permission. And I loved this idea, because how many times do we allow, well, I just go ahead and, like you said, go back to that habit. So she made a promise. She did nothing. She couldn't look at her phone. She couldn't read a book. She couldn't look at a magazine. She had to sit there for 20 minutes. Within a minute, she'd go do the task that she needed to get done, because.
I like that.
Yeah.
I like that. It's a little bit like, for me, what's coming up for me is when you're talking is that fact that I will go do a 10-minute meditation now, mm-hmm. Right? If I get stressed and I want to go to my refrigerator, I'll be like, okay, I'll say, am I hungry?
Yep.
Nope, not hungry. Okay, let me do a 10-minute meditation. Because what I'm really looking for is that break from my computer, something to break the cycle of stress. And yep. The meditation can do the same thing for me if I'm not hungry.
Absolutely. Yeah. Right?
So I think we all avoid things we don't want to do related to our business and our personal lives really well.
Yeah, I'm great at that.
I'm actually pretty great at that too. And I'm a workaholic. I love to work, but right? Still sometimes I need to avoid it and I'll do these crazy things. So anyway, this is a little bit different for our lives. We usually try to give specific tips, but I think that when everyone's going into summer and looking at your life and looking at your goals, we're in the second quarter now. What habits are serving you well? What habits are not serving you well? And starting to recognize your triggers and what the rewards are for these habits that are, moving you away from your goals as opposed to towards your goal is something that's worth looking into. So that's why I wanted to have this conversation today.
Yeah, it's a great one because we all struggle with this. It's good to remember that just because somebody looks like they have it all together, they struggle with this too.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And that's another reason, right? We like to have real conversation. We are real people. You may see us online as like, oh my God, they're so consistent. They do this, they do that. But there's real struggles for humans. We're all humans. Exactly. So yeah, real conversation. All right. So if you need a fabulous website, look up Teresa because she's your gal. And if you are struggling with bad habits that are causing you not to be running a profitable business, that you're not confident enough to charge your worth, you don't understand your ladder of services, different service models for different needs at different price points, all of which should be profitable, confidence, all that kind of stuff, that's what I'm here for. So reach out to me if you need my help. You know where to find us. You can just tag us in the group or go to the website, Web Designs by Teresa or nancyganzacoffer.com. Thanks, Teresa.
Right. Thank you.
All right. Talk to you guys soon. Bye. Bye.